Ladies and gentlemen, I am really proud to introduce Zuzi for the fourth time, I think, on this conference. Excellent, in 6 years. I think that's best ever. So it's a tough job now, because you need to surprise us with something exciting and new, something we haven't seen yet here in Latvia.
I'll do my best.
Super. All right, the floor is yours.
Okay, thank you. Yeah. Can I ask you to stand up to do some small, tiny experiment? Yeah. Plus, it's good for your brain because it's the afternoon, etc. You need some oxygen. So what I want you to do is to imagine the best organization, the organization of your dream. Try to have it, that picture in your mind. And think about what makes it different. Well, how do people behave there? What are the values? What makes it different from all the other organizations you ever seen? And now, compare it to your organization where you work now. And if it's very different, you can sit down. Only if it's very different, guys. Ah, now some people are standing. Okay, now you see, like, I don't know, 20% people standing. That's cool. Now, if it's not the organization where you work, you can sit down. If it's not the organization where you work, you can sit down. Well, congratulations to you. You work in your organization of your dream. Thank you. You can sit down. For the rest of you, let's try to talk a little bit about the history, where the organization started. And in, you know, 1970s, it was an organization 1.0, as I just call it for easy reference. And those organizations look like a pyramid with a strong boss on the top. That person was saying, like, I knew better than you guys. And I tell you what to do. So it's an organization, a lot of power, hierarchy, resources. And, you know, standardization, bureaucracy. But actually, it was a good match for the world at that time. So most of those problems, 1970s, been kind of simple. And they need a simple solution, simple structures. So actually, those organizations been successful. They've been growing. And they become bigger and more successful and bigger and bigger and bigger. And then the life changed. And actually, before it changed, that's what they use. That's the management tool, the carrot and stick. Because the belief in the organization 1.0 was, you know, those employees are those lazy slackers who just don't work. Unless we stay here with a stick and tell them, hey, you have to work. Every morning you have to come here 8:00. And you can't leave for a longer lunch than 30 minutes. Otherwise, and if you do your job very well, you got a bonus, right? That's a carrot and stick, pretty much. And those guys, they are full of complaints. I have a bad life. My life sucks because I have a bad boss. And my life sucks because I don't really see any value out of the work I do. It's just a boring job. Not really fun place to be. So it was not sustainable. So even if the life would not change, those organizations would have to transform. And they did. So the life changed to be more complicated. Because 20 years after, we've got here the globalization. So the companies become so big that one country, one region was not enough. And even if you're a small company, you are most likely involved by what's happening over there in China and over there in the US and over there in here, Riga. Who knows, right? It's not isolated anymore. And they're complicated. And in this complicated world, you know what we need? Specialization. We need those experts. We need those creative workers, those people who are smart. So we build departments for every single activity you can ever imagine. And we build those processes for every single thing you do. And those organizations, there are a lot of learning, a lot of managers. And they speak about delegation, but they keep the power. And they talk about allocations, position, career paths, specialization structures. You know, those departments, they start as a really meaningful way. We have a Java developers. We've got those testers. We have a database specialist, security guys. And somewhere at the end of your organization, you got the people who decide on which chair are you going to sit, because they knew better than you do. They are the experts on buying the chairs. And as those companies going bigger and more successful, they got more departments, more processes, more rules, more structure. They become more and more difficult to even understand and do things. So you end up one morning saying like, well, 20 years back, I still remember it. Or 5 years back, I still remember that. It was a nice life. I could do this work in like one day. And now I have to get approval from that department. Once they give it to me, I have to ask that guy to create it in a system. And then. And in 2 months, we have that tiny functionality. Isn't it? No, it's not that great. Anyway. But actually, specialization, we are great. We are experts. We are better. I am better than the others, not we. I am better than the others. And therefore, I tell you what to do. So that's the mindset here. I am great, you're not. Right? And here, the leaders believe they are here to give you orders. Because of course, in a specialization world, there is no smart people except you. It's a good thing. It's still much better than the previous world where everybody's been demotivated. Now most of the people feels like an experts. Most of them, not all of them. And the world doesn't wait. The internet is coming and makes it even more global and more fast and more changing every like single minute. And the companies realized, some of those companies who didn't die, they realized they have to change as well. And they have to address that complexity and do something differently, significantly differently than they did past decades. And that's where we start to talk about agile organization. We talk about leadership, partnership. We talk about collaboration, responsibility and ownership, right? We talk about autonomy and those living organisms and people who just are together. Very different environment. And I want to share with you a story of my life. One summer afternoon, I've been given 3 departments. One of them been running in Agile, the other 2 very traditional ones. It was a software developers, software testers, and hardware guys. And our owners of that 120 company, they said like, hey, think about the structure of your new department. But actually we have to combine it because we need to build cross-functional teams for our customers. So can you do that? I was like, yes, I can. I can! Right? I've been happy. The first feeling was like, I can change it. I can finally make those people like happy and enthusiastic. So that was my first feeling. Then I went home, sit in the garden and think about it. open that document, which we got online on with all those processes which your department head has to do. And those processes which you have to follow. And I guess I've got the opportunity to change those, but it was, I can't even read it in 1 week. And we've been 120 people company. Not that big, right? So I went to sleep, and actually I've got a dream about, it was a kind of a nightmare, that you imagine you sitting in your office, and all those 120 people are standing in a queue in front of your door because they ask you for permission. And can you approve this? Can you allow me to go for a holiday? And I need your signature. And can you decide if we go this or that way? And I was like almost screaming out of sleeping and saying like, no, I'm not going to do that. But then what was expected from me, from our owners, was like, hey, manager number one, manager number two, three, four, and five. They've got their teams, hierarchy. And I decided to fight with it. So I sat to the computer and searched for some case studies of a flat organization. I talked to the scrum masters we've got and talked to some other people who could potentially become a great scrum masters. And week after, I've been presenting a very flat structure based on cross-functional self-organizing teams who are empowered and can solve most of their problems by themselves with a collaboration. And actually, in 9 months, that became true and it was sustainable because I left for my 5 weeks holiday and they didn't need me. So I was very proud on them. So that was my kind of first real experience with Agile organization. And I'm so happy about that decision because the people were just awesome. They make much better decisions than I would ever get myself. So a little bit about the theories which helps you to understand how the Agile organization works. So one of them is tribal leadership. This book here, Tribal Leadership, says that actually every company has some dominant tribe. The first one is like, life sucks, and that's very bad environment. You can imagine those street gangs, mafias, prisons, right? Not really common in organizations where you work, most likely. Like 2% of population. About 20% of population still live in that my life sucks. That's the organization 1.0, very common tribe. They complain about everything, they're unhappy. Then the organization 2.0 with those experts and specialists saying like, I am great and you are not, right? And then we are slowly getting into something which we try to build with all that Agile and Scrum thing, saying like, we are great. It's not about me and you anymore. We and these teams are great. And we as this organization are great. That's something you try to achieve with Agile and Scrum. And nowadays we have about, again, 20% of people who are there. And there is one more, which is even more interesting. If you finally achieve that Agile organization and you have a strong, meaningful goal, what do you want to do and achieve in your life as this organization, then those companies, like 3% again worldwide, are in the last stage. Life is great. And they have no competitors anymore because this guy said, we just fight cancer. What do you mean competitors? Oh, there is the other company. They work with us, kind of. Yeah, they're a different business, but it's not about the money. It's about changing the world. And this is one of the reasons why I am with the Scrum Alliance, because the Scrum Alliance motto says, we transform the way of work. So we want to change people's lives. We want to make them more happy. And it's something which is appealing to me. So that's that stage. So that's something you want to build. Start with a small team and say like, we are great, and then move it to the organization and the whole society, maybe. Leadership. leadership has to follow, right? Or start it even. Traditional leadership says, I am a leader, I give you orders, and you follow. Yeah, because I am great, you're not, right? That's pretty much coming together. So what we have to change when we switch to agile organization, we try to build it on a so-called servant leadership. And in this book, David Logan, David Market, call it turn the ship, in his book, Turn the Ship Around, calls it leader-leader. So it's a management where you believe that the other people can become great leaders. And all your goal is to allow them and help them to grow and become better. And how can I help people around me is the most ultimate question. Because if I help them, they'll figure it out. They're great. They can make it. And once you get through those two theories of a culture and a leadership, then you are maybe ready for this one. The book is called Leadership and Self-Deception. And it pretty much doesn't say anything new. It just says, hey, let's treat the other people as people and not as roles. So I'll give you a few examples so you a little bit understand what I'm speaking about. So let's imagine, you know, in these days I travel a lot and usually flying somewhere. And they usually take you by the bus from the airplane to the terminal. I don't know why they don't use those nice devices up there. But they take you by the bus. And let's imagine you've been lucky, you go out of the plane early, so you have a seat. They don't have too many seats in those buses because they're only going the short distance, right? And accidentally, there is a lady with a small child. So what do you do? Are you going to sit there and say, hey, it's just somebody who, some another passenger who came late? Too bad. I'm here first. And by the way, I'm tired. I have to teach the whole day a class and I'm really tired and I need to sit down and just, you know, sleep. Or what do you stand up and say, hey, that other person might need to sit down and take it as a person and let them to decide if they need to or not? Or are you trying to find another excuses like say, hey, planes are not for kids. It's a bad mother. She should not travel with her kid. She should be at home and play at the playground. She has no right to sit down. And once you move there, your excuses start to be more and more weird. Because you naturally close yourself in a box with your first decision not to treat people as a people, but as a roles, just a passenger. I am a weird passenger, right, with a kid, but still a passenger, not a person. And then you go home, right, another story, and your wife or a husband might not go with a trash, and you believe that's their role because they've been the whole day at home. So they should go as a trash, right? Isn't that their duty? Yeah, it is, yeah? So you start to be angry and say like, hey, you've been the whole day at home. And you didn't have a 5 minutes. Or instead you just say, hey, maybe he was or she was tired or she's got some other things to do. So talk about it as a people-to-people personality. And then it's your work, right? There is a developer who made a bug, and actually the whole system crashed. What are you going to do? Say, hey, it's a poor developer, look at him. Or are you going to say, hey, okay, what are we going to do differently together next time? So it will never happen. We don't allow those bugs and mistakes happen to our people. Think about that, right? Don't close yourself in a box of the roles and descriptions. Just say, hey, we are all people, let's talk, let's discuss, let's have a conversation. And it's closely related to the responsibility. I've been in one company, quite a, you know, small company, 300 people. Not really that big, he would say. They've got four owners. And those owners, well, 20 years back, they like each other, right? They've been friends. Therefore, they started a company. But 20 years after, they can't speak with each other. So they figure out that they have to divide the company by certain responsibilities. So he is responsible for finances, and he is responsible for software development, and he's responsible for business, and the other one for, I'm not sure what, doesn't matter. Marketing, maybe. So distribute responsibilities. It sounds like a good idea. So you come up with an expert. But if you do it at the top company level, it starts to behave as this nice one garden. One person just wants to plant a vegetable, and the other one build a tree. And at the beginning, it doesn't matter. The tree is small, the vegetable is not that big. And then the tree grows, and the shadows start to go to the other parts of the garden. And they are not that happy anymore. They are not growing that much. So eventually, they start fighting and saying, hey, you are not allowed to have that tree so close to us. And you have to change because they didn't like each other and they go down to the spiral into a disaster. Christopher Avery, and there was a talk just before me in that other room where the speaker's been describing his responsibility process, says with responsibility, start with what we can do differently next time. It's not about blaming. It's not about telling, hey, it's your fault. Look at your garden. Look at those flowers. They are not good. You have to improve them. It's like, oh, what can we do? So we make this garden nice and living and combine again together. What we can change. It's a shared responsibility. That's something which we forgot how it looks like in most of our organizations. And in Agile, we try to find it again through the retrospectives and through just some colleague conversations. How can we change it together? What shall we do next time differently? Okay, it was not really good, so how about next time? How we react? Think about it. How life would look without the blame. And we know there are like four toxins, right? And every company would have some of those. On the other hand, every one of you would drink a vodka or a rum or whiskey. And it's okay, you get a glass, you're fine. You might be even more funny colleague to listen. It might be a nice company for that evening after one glass. But if you drink a bottle, you start to be annoying, usually. Well, some of you can drink a bottle and no one recognizes, but I can't. So we try to be annoying and it starts to be too toxic environment. And the same thing happening in the organizations. So if there is a little blame, little defensiveness, little stonewalling or little contempt, the organization is quite healthy and they can handle it, right? But if it starts to be too big, they start fighting. And they are not a nice place to be at anymore. And the more they blame, the more defensiveness they are, the more some people repeat all the time the same things all about around, 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 because I'm right and you're not. And then you're going down the spiral into the wrong dead end of your organization. Think about it. How come if you just build a trust and say, hey, instead of blaming and defensiveness, and instead of stonewalling and contempt, how about if we just discuss together, how do we want to be? Just have a conversation. Start with a team and talk, how do we want to react next time when we see somebody make a mistake? Or what do we want to say instead of stonewalling, like repeating all the time the same things around, when we feel somebody is not listening. Let's make a couple of team agreements. Let's design a team alliance. What makes us a great team? Because there are always things which can make you to be a wonderful, awesome team. Let's write them somewhere on the wall so everybody can see it, and then discuss what are we going to do if things go difficult. Okay, so we want to be with no blaming, no defensiveness, no stalling, no toxins at all. Awesome team. But do we believe in it? I'm afraid that when we make a mistake, somebody just starts to blame again. So how we react as a team, how we protect that person. Let's make a couple of those agreements. How are we going to help each other in those difficult times? And then make it open, visible somewhere for the team so you can point your finger to that agreement and say, hey, you see? Okay, I guess it was a blaming, so what can we do instead, right? Slowly by slowly, it gets better. One of the funny thing is the influence of positivity. This gentleman, John Gottman, did a research on positivity. And he did a research on actually couples. And he can predict with a high probability if the couple got divorced or stay together a few years before, right? And how he did it, he just listened to their conversation about some issues they got together and how they react. And he said that for every negative event, you have to have at least 5 positive ones. And then you stay together as a couple. For every 1 negative, have 5 positive. Think about your conversation with your girlfriends, boyfriends, families. How is that? And then he repeated for the work environment and did the same research for teams. And he actually said it works the same way. For every 1 negative one, you had 5 positive events. That's actually what we try to do with the retrospective, where we at the beginning focus on that what went well or what would we like to keep, what is great, we want to continue with. But some teams are doing that positivity wall, so they just make those positive things visual. So anyone see that they like something, like this guy came from a holiday, and the other one say, hey, we got a bill with no bugs, awesome, let's celebrate. And I just feel happy, and I love those Friday beers. Just make it visible for everyone. Don't miss one single opportunity to celebrate. Even a small event is good to celebrate. It raises your chances that you're gonna be a great team together. It works the same way as your account, currency account. Let's imagine that your positivity always add something to your account. So the balance is higher and higher and higher. And then if something negative comes, you're okay. It's the same thing. If I have a high balance of my currency account and I got a fine, I'm not happy about that fine. I'm actually quite pissed off. But I can survive, right? I have a lower balance. But I can still go to the restaurant for the evening, I can still pay for my rent, and I can still buy a gift to my partner. Not a big deal, right? I'm not happy, but it's not a big deal. But if I have just around 0 balance of my account and I got a fine, I have a problem. Because that small even fine means that I can't go tomorrow on a lunch with a team because I just don't have enough money. And I can't pay rent. So that's the same thing. Keep the positivity high enough. So whatever happens, it doesn't kill you. You have still enough energy to say, okay, well, that can happen. Let's talk about what are we going to do differently next time. And you still smile. After all, Agile. All Agile is about change. And the change works like this very steep hill. You have to cross it. So here is your primary side, that's where you are before the change, the where you like it. And on the other side, that's the secondary, that's where you gonna be once you change. So when we start the Agile journey, here is the traditional environment, and here is the Agile. And through that time, we have to cross some small edges and small hills. Like, well, yeah, I have to share something with those team members. And I have to be transparent with our users. Really? I have to show them what we delivered and ask them for a feedback and welcome that feedback even late stages of software development. Really? And then step by step, you got used to those tiny, small things, and they become your natural way. And if you go slowly enough, you're just gonna go around it. But if someone push you too much, then you push back and reject and fall down completely. So I would say that 30% of organizations are failing because they don't manage a change. They just feel it happened overnight. One day we are traditional, the other day we are agile. Or maybe next month. Yeah, next month, it could be feasible. I'm sure. It's simple, right? I read it in a Scrum guide, they got only 16 pages. So what? But actually, it's not. And for some people, it might be very difficult at the beginning, and then they go smoothly. For some other people, it might be the most difficult to flip over the edge. And therefore, we need those leaders in the organization who would help us to go slowly over the edge. And sometimes just look at there, hey, have a look at that team. Aren't that great? And see how they take over the responsibility. Can you imagine that that thing would happen here? No, I can't, but I like it. But I'm afraid. And they are balancing like that on the edge, right? They like what they see, but they are afraid at the same moment. And be kind of them, be nice to them, and guide them through the top very slowly. My most favorite book on actually change management is from John Cotter. It's a fable of this penguins colony, and it's called Our Iceberg is Melting, and it describes those 8 steps of successful change. And I think it's a must-have read for every Scrum Master, because after all, they are responsible for implementing Agile change, Agile journey, Agile transformation, if you want to call it that way. And the first step, which most of the companies forgot when they want to change to Agile, is like a reason. Create a sense of urgency, they said here in this book. So what I ask my clients is always like, why do you want to change to Agile? Because it's new? Because I said a minute ago that it's the best way to work? Or why? Why would you change? You know, you are good. You just said you're profitable. You're delivering, so what? What do you need? What's your goal? What's your dream? What you can have right now? And if they don't have it, if they don't have any dream they would like to achieve, they're never gonna make it, because Agile is not your goal. It's just the most efficient way how to achieve your goals. But you have to have your business-related goals. You have to have something which is strategic you want to achieve. If you have it, that force would gonna help you to overcome those difficulties and finally make that change. I've got it. Because my dream with that organization was that actually I can look into a very different areas. I can work with some other people on more creative things, like how can we build a product? Because we've been service-oriented company. Or how can we make this service in a very different way, more flexible? How can we change the way we are into something different? And I actually have got another dream. I want to go for my typical 5-week long holiday to just refresh. And I want to make myself redundant enough so I can disappear and it will be running by itself very well. And when I go in with a new fresh mind, I can just say, hey, how about if we go here and here and here and there and give a new energy into the company. But I don't want to be there hidden in those Excel sheets and processes and day-to-day operation. That was not my dream. I knew that I would never accept a director job if it would be about operational tasks. I accepted it because I want to move the company to a different level. So have a goal, create a sense of urgency. And one of the next steps is like celebrate the success. We are back to the positivity, right? You have to celebrate things. You have to show the others that you are great. Niels Fleming wrote a book about a year ago, Organize for Complexity. And it's an interesting book. It says how to get life back into work to build high performance organizations. High performance, right? And he speaks a lot about decentralization. So he said, like, and that's quite common belief here in a complex world. You can't have one person or one entity who would direct the rest. It must be decentralized based on self-organizing entities. And they are dependent to each other. They have some linkage to each other. They belong to each other. They are not completely independent, but still they can decide. So the image in my mind, it's like imagine a huge tanker, the huge boat, right? Those huge, huge boats where you can have several cars on top of them. In traditional way, that's the organization. It has a captain who tells the boat, go that direction and now stop, right? In Agile, that's not our vision of an organization. We still have a boat in this image. But we have several boats, like a flotilla, who goes to this one certain direction. They have one mission. And some of those might need to take a sidetrack because of wind. And some of the others might need to show the other way and slow down because of the waves. They can make those day-to-day decisions by themselves. They are empowered to make them, but they have one unifying goal. So the one thing which helps me to be successful with my vision of a self-organizing teams and the self-organizing department and actually the whole organization was have a strong goal. So I came next day after the weekend to the company and told them like, you know, that's what I want. That's what I want to achieve. I would like to be able to do this, this and that. Be flexible. Be fast reacting to our customer requests. Be able to take this and this and this job which we had to refuse in the past. And my way to achieve it is to have a self-organizing teams who would get some empowerment and independency. They can decide. They don't have to wait for me or for anybody else. And once they understand the vision, the overall goal, they start to come up with new ideas how they can achieve it. And decentralization in the organization could be like, you know, the open space running every month on some strategic ideas. Or you might do the word cafe format where the people talk in the small groups and they shift around and talk again and shift around and summarize it. Or just, you know, build some communities and virtual teams. Maybe you have a problem with the tools, so let's build a community who would try to analyze it and figure it out and tell the others how we can react, how we can improve it. Figure out what's the problem and address it. After all, I learned that the organization is a system. It's a complex system, and we have to look at it from the top. So let's imagine you look from your for your organization from like 1 kilometer distance. So you don't see those tiny problems of each individual. You don't have to solve them. You just look at it as a system which is like constantly moving somewhere and sometimes giving you some voices like, hey, here is a problem. Hey, we are having a pain. Can you help us? Right? It's the same thing. If you have your hand hit the wall, and you say, hey, it's... And then the rest of the body knew it, right? The same thing with a team. The rest of the organization knew it. They are a living organism, the same as your body. So they are not independent, but they are still have an autonomy. There is a great book, Management 3.0, which is a good starter for leaders to and managers in the organization to just say, hey, okay, that's all nice, but where should I start with the practical practices? Something which I can start tomorrow. How to do the KPIs differently? How to make performance reviews? How to motivate people? How to delegate? That's all there. Jürgen did a wonderful, awesome job. He collected like everything you can ever imagine into that book and some of his other new books. So give it a try. But think about it. It's a system. Look at it from the system perspective, from atop. I finished the book, which is called The Great Scrum Master, and it actually summarized a couple of those concepts which I put here. And one of the most important one, which is there, like, you're never gonna be done. Even if you read all those books which I put there, and all the other 20 books which you got from the bookstore, you apply them, you're never gonna be done. There is always going to be a better way how to do things. Learn. Improve. Look for creative ideas how to address the complexity of a nowadays world. If you do that, you're going to be successful. If you don't, you may end up like those companies who used to be the best mobile phone ever. Do you remember the best mobile phone company? Nokia? Where is Nokia now, right? And that can happen to your organization as well if you don't change. Ah, some people love Nokia still. In general, if you want to start the organization, start with the leaders. And the leaders has to change first. And it starts with a get awareness about the system. Okay, that organization behaves differently. It's like a living organism. It's like a network of those self-organizing teams. Okay, I can observe it, I can feel it, I can touch it. And then you move to the next stage, you just embrace it and say, hey, I trust it. I actually understand it. I'm good with it. That feels like I can drive it to a certain direction again. I can do that. I'm not disconnected anymore. They are not disattached. They are part of me. I am part of them. We are one organization, one system together. And then the only thing is, how am I going to change it? How can I coach the system? So it's going to go to the strategic direction to achieve those goals somewhere there. How can I do that? Right? So that's something which I now teach at the Certified Agile Leadership classes, which we do as a new thing, to address that disconnect. We found out at the Scrum Alliance that some of the organizations are failing because of a disconnect between the leaders and the teams below. Those leaders look at those teams and say, like, yeah, well, they have those best clocks, and yeah, they deliver something, but how can I drive them? How can I control them? How can I tell them even where to go? They feel like complete disconnect and completely lost. So we try to help them to understand how the Agile organization works and how to become an efficient leader. After all, the Organization 3.0 is a network. Constantly moving, constantly changing a shape, collaborative, creative, adaptive network. And if you want to build it, help all people to become better leaders. That's the leader model. How can I help the others to become leaders? They are great. They're gonna make it. They are the best people you ever can get in the organization. Decentralize, give them trust, build networks and communities. Trust them, they're gonna make it. And they will. And create a positive environment. Celebrate even a tiny success. Appreciate their initiatives. Because if you say them, hey, thank you, it was a great workshop, they do it again. There is a high chance that somebody else will step out with another brilliant idea and try it again. So make it positive environment and you got your results. So thank you very much. And if you have any questions, we still have about 10 minutes.
Please, anyone. Otherwise, I will enforce a technique where I will ask you to discuss this first. Huh? Excellent.
Yes, thanks for the presentation. Do you have some thoughts about what is coming as Organization 4.0?
That's a great question, but unfortunately I don't. I think it's gonna be even fast, change responsive, even more dynamic, and even less centralized than it is now. But actually, if I knew it, I would be the most successful person in the universe, I guess. So we'll have to wait for it. Who knows?
Right. Should we balance the room? We had the question from this side, so we are great, right? So we need
anyone
this side as well. Come on.
Ask anything, right? Ask
anything. Sure.
It's a what?
Oh, excellent.
I'm holding the microphone.
Thank you for the presentation. I was wondering, what is your opinion about till organization, sociocracy? This is a new way of organizing. What can you give us your feedback about?
Yeah, I like till. That's the ultimate, you know, agile organization with like flat structures and, but still the leadership, not really the classical management, but still the leadership in place, right? So I didn't really build it on top of that red, orange, green and teal from LaRocque's model, where the red and orange, I would say, is like organization 1.0. And there it starts, because how it's originally specified, it says like then it's a green and then it's a teal, like linear process, but I don't really see it that way. I think there is a red-orange thing, which is 1.0, 2.0 pretty much, and then there is like a green and teal. I see it more as a triangle where maybe the organizations are going to complete green, like apply Scrum in its pure form and still go the organizational structure, which is hierarchical. To just delegate little or some responsibilities for the Scrum Masters, product owners, teams, and the overall agile environment. And some organizations might go even without agile to complete flat structure to do teal, when they're saying, one organization from Prague, where I live, is called Etnetera. And I think they are a good prototype of a teal organization. Because they never, well, they did some experiments with Scrum and Kanban and Agile. And maybe some teams are really using Scrum still, I don't really know. But as an organization, it's not important for them. They use it as one of many methods. And they said, like, we want to create a really flat organizational structure with no managers. And at the beginning, I didn't really understand, like, why no managers? You still need a leadership, right? And now I guess I understand it. They just want to allow anyone from our entire big, now they have about, again, 300 people-ish, something, in a few groups. They want to allow anyone to come up with any initiative, any idea. And if it's a good idea, you just say it loud, talk about it with your colleagues and you form a team around you. And then they tell you like, you know what, I want to work with you. I hear you are doing this. Can I help you? Can I be part of your team, right? So it starts to be a snowball effect if it's a great idea and if you have some leadership skills. If you don't, you come up with some idea, we'll say, no, I'll do it, whatever, but no. So they really create that environment that everybody can come up with any idea they want. And if they are supported with the others, they can continue. And they make everything quite transparent, so everybody see what everybody else is doing. And they do the experiment. So for quite some time, they've been running a video interviews with all the different people in the Czech Republic, from Agile space, but not only, the startups scene, etc. And then they just say, hey, we did it. Now I'm after this. And they move somewhere else. So there is like no defined way that we have to continue. We just do it until we feel it brings value to the company. And then we drop it and take something else which we believe will bring a higher value. So I think that's a pure deal. And they don't really need to be agile-driven organization for their product or services. And then there are some companies who are in between or who might get both, right? So I think it's a like more complex spectrum than just the linear development that every company would have to become till. I don't see it that way.
Thank you.
So one more, the last one. I have a question, but it's forming and I will ask you tomorrow.
You got a question?
It's forming.
Forming?
I'll ask it tomorrow.
Okay.
Maybe someone has it today. No. I guess people need time.
Yeah. It's okay.
A round of applause for Susie. Thank you.